Welcome to Applied Mathematical Finance, Computational Finance and its Object-Oriented Implementation. Yeah, let's shortly remind you that in our last session, we were looking at the valuation of the foreign caplet and the quantum caplet. So the foreign caplet is just paying a foreign interest rate. But since you are a domestic investor, it is converted to your currency. And it's then the result is just the classical valuation formula, the same that you would get for the corresponding model for a domestic caplet. The quantum caplet was then a bit more interesting. So we were paying here the foreign interest rate. So that is here a foreign quantity. So all foreign quantities get this tilde. So we are paying the foreign forward rate. Well, remember the forward rate is unitless apart from this one divided by time, but here's the multiplication with the period length. So this is just a unitless amount. Then this was paid in domestic currency. Yeah, so you see here there's one domestic, so the foreign currency is actually canceling. So I multiply this unitless amount with one domestic currency, and this is somewhat the unnatural way of paying it. The other one is the more natural one. And if you would like to note this, so we have here an index L tilde. So forget about the maximum stuff. This is paid in, and now in units of one domestic currency. Well, but then also try to encode when it is paid. So it is paid at the end of the period in T2. So I can write that this is paid in units of the zero coupon bond that is one in T2, because the zero coupon bond is the value that is one in T2. And if you are here taking into account that we have a fixing earlier, you could move this by just multiplying with the zero coupon bond. Okay, so you see that we pay some index in some units, and then we observed that the natural numerator would be the foreign bond converted to domestic currency, because I know that the index is a martingale under this numerator. Yeah? So I would like to choose this guy because I know that the index has a nice property. But then if we look at the payment, so the slide which we just had, I pay in units of this zero coupon bond. So with respect to the payment, this zero coupon bond is maybe the nicer object. Yeah, because why, if I choose this as a numerator, then if you think of the universal valuation theorem, this numerator, so this here is the stuff that contains the index, is actually canceling out in the expectation operator. Well, in this special case, the numerator is also one, so you do not really see that it is canceling because it's just one. But if you think that you would take here an earlier point, yeah, then at the payment time, then it would also cancel. So motivation was that from the expectation operator, I would like to get rid of this part here. I would like to get rid of this part. So that numerator is maybe the nicer one, but from the martingale property, I would like to choose that one. And then we proceeded in the derivation. So we had to derive the stochastic process under this unnatural numerator. And we introduced here this quantity FFX. So we introduced this object, which is just the change of numerator. So it is the natural one divided by the one which we would like to have. Okay, so it is our change of numerator. And then we observed L tilde multiplied with the change of numerator is a martingale that allowed us to derive the drift under the new numerator PT2. And you see the L tilde is no longer the martingale under this measure. Okay, so this led to an adjustment in the valuation formula. If we started with the Black-Scholes model, it was then an adjusted Black formula. And today I would like to generalize this. Property that if you change the, say, payoff unit, we have to make this maybe a bit precise. This leads to the so-called convexity adjustments. And it's a very general scheme. And I will also motivate a little bit why it is called convexity. Okay, so we are discussing here the so-called convexity adjustments. So we introduce it as a little bit more general concept. And many adjustments are of this form. So the in-arrears adjustment, the so-called CMS adjustment, constant maturity swap, or the one that we have already introduced, the Quantu adjustment, are of this form. Okay, let's start with a motivation. And as a motivation, let's go back to the part where we introduced the first products. So the very first product was the one that was paying the floating rate, so the floater that was paying the forward rate, yeah, multiplied with the period length at the end of the period. And somehow, if you go back to where we derived this, so that was here this theorem 131. We observed that there was some magic happening because the time at which we pay it, so here is the payment, the time at which we pay this amount somehow fits nicely to the stochastic index that we pay, because choosing the bond that matures here, this guy is a martingale. And the bond that matures here is one in this point. Yeah, so it's just the expectation of a martingale. And so we know that the value is just today's value of this guy multiplied with the zero coupon bond. So the proof then just proceeded that we could write here the value of this floater at an earlier time as just observing the index at this earlier time multiplied with the period length multiplied with the zero coupon bond at this earlier time. So we already observed this very nice property in this theorem. So the result was that we didn't need a model. So a nice thing is that no model was required for our stochastic process. Yeah, it was just sufficient to know the initial value, yeah, because it is a martingale. So here again, a recapitulation of the steps that we had in the proof of the theorem. And where we had different versions, yeah, this is the second version of the proof. So we like to value the payment of our index. It's paid at time ti plus one. And as our numerator, we choose the zero coupon bond that matures at ti plus one. So this means that here you could actually say that, okay, the nice thing is that this zero coupon bond is one at the payment time. So you see already at this point, the numerator by the special choice disappears from the expectation operator. But to see this a little bit more clearly, you could also rewrite the payment as paying in time TI. So now I'm paying here in time TI. Okay, but if I move the payment date, you remember we had a remark on this, then of course I have to multiply here on top with the zero coupon bond that pays at the end of the period. And now you see that there is indeed the situation we paid this index multiplied with a zero coupon bond that is one at the end of the period. So this here is then a little bit rewriting as if we have payment in TI. Yeah? So that's just for a didactical reason, because now you really see that the financial product that appears here on top is the same as our numerator. Okay, so the numerator cancels. So you can take either argument that the numerator cancels. So you do not have anything else except the index in this expectation. And then the second property was that we have an expectation of this guy, and Li is a Q PTI plus one martingale. And since it is a martingale, I have that the value is just the value at evaluation time. Okay, and for the universal pricing theorem, of course, you have to multiply here with the numerator at evaluation time. Okay, so there is a numerator at evaluation time here. So this means that this is multiplied with the zero coupon bond observed at evaluation time, paying one unit in TI plus one. Okay, so that was the derivation, and you see two aspects come together in a very lucky way. Yeah, the numerator vanishes in the expectation operator, or a financial product, choosing it as a numerator vanishes in the expectation operator, and the guy is a martingale under this measure. So two properties lead to this special result. So the first one was that the chosen numerator drops out of the expectation operator. And the second one is that our index, so the remaining term, is a martingale under that specific numerator, or under that specific measure. So maybe we should generalize this and define this property, well, say, as some kind of natural payoff unit. Okay, and the convexity adjustment will then be the case where we pay in a different unit. So consider in a more general case a derivative that depends on some index. So I have here some index X, a stochastic process. X of T1 is then the random variable, so fixed in T1. And I assume now that I have some numerator N under which this X is a martingale. So next, my financial product is assumed to pay a function of this index. So it pays here a function f of x of ti in units of this numerator, so in units of n of t2. So the payment is in time t2. So I pay in units of n of t2. So there is here t2 and my n. And the amount that I pay is just a function, this f of x1. So I consider this general case. Yeah, many financial products are of this form. Yeah, so also the European options, yeah, where F is the maximum function. Well, if F is linear, and remember that I mentioned that you could also call some products linear products. So if we have the special case that F is linear, then we can immediately give a model independent analytic value for this payoff. Okay, why? Okay, because if F is linear, I have that expectation of F of X of T1 conditional to time, say, zero, is just F of X0, because a linear function of a martingale is a martingale, and I have the assumption that my X is a martingale under Qn. Okay, so I can immediately use this, and you see I'm paying in units of n. So if I value now the payoff V of T2, so this is here my V of T2 on top here, then the numerator will cancel. So the units of n cancel if I choose n as a numerator. Okay, and I just have expectation of this coupon, and my coupon was here this function of the index. Okay, so I just have C of zero multiplied, of course, with my numerator in zero. Yeah, there's still numerator in zero here. So that was all the magic that occurred in the so-called linear products. Also for the swap, yeah, there was the numerator is the swap annuity. Yeah, everything was like that. For the forward rate, the numerator is the zero coupon bond. So example was the floater, where we used the zero coupon bond paying at the end of the period as the numerator. Then we had a session on nonlinear products, so our options. Yeah? So there was the caplet, the swaption, you remember? So we had different European options. So in that case, we could derive an analytic valuation formula assuming a special model. So for example, we assumed the Black model or the Bachelier model. So assuming a special model then allowed us to calculate the probability distribution of our index at fixing time. So here at this time T1. Yeah. So we knew the probability distribution of X at T1. And so we could calculate the expectation of F of this index, because F was a nice function, the maximum function. So we somewhat could calculate this. Well, actually, you can do this for all piecewise linear functions F. So whenever F is piecewise linear, then you can derive such an analytic formula. So, yeah, given that the distribution is nice. So in our case, for example, log normal or normal. So the whole section on the nonlinear products on our European options, caplet, swaption, relied on the two aspects that we had a nice model. So X of T was log normal or normal, and the function F was piecewise linear. Apart from that, we had these properties, yeah? So the index, or a function of the index in that case, was paid in the natural unit, the unit under which the index is a martingale. So many financial products are of this form. So for example, here you find a list, yeah? And this also relates back, yeah, so now many things from the previous sections are connected to our generalized Black-Scholes formula. Remember, in the generalized Black-Scholes formula, I introduced a quantity f, so that was here f of t, which was the stock divided by the zero Cooper bond at exercise of the option. And then I introduced a quantity M, which was the guy that I choose as numerator. And the observation was that the whole generalized derivation of this formula, of the Black-Scholes formula, relied on the fact that this F is a martingale under this measure corresponding to this numerator. Yeah, because it is the relative price of a traded asset divided by the numerator. So in the case of the Black-Scholes model, this zero Cooper bond was just using deterministic interest rate e to the r t minus t. Wait, there's a minus missing, right? Yeah, there's a minus missing. Sorry here, there should be a minus, okay. Small typo. So in the Black-Scholes case, so for this generalized formula, I choose this guy. So you see, this is just a scaling of our numerator b of t, yeah, of the e to the rt numerator. Yeah? It's, I just multiply with e to the minus r capital T. So that was the case for the option. Yeah, so actually the line with the option is here. If you go back to the generalized Black-Scholes formula, of course, if you just would like to value the equity forward, yeah, paying a stock in the future, then the function is just the identity. Okay, and this game goes on, you know, for many different financial products. For example, the introduction which I just made was the floater. So we were paying the forward rate Li. So Li here denotes the rate from Ti to Ti plus one. So the forward rate is paid in units of the zero Cooper bond maturing in Ti plus one. And then I also multiply with the period length. Yeah? So I pay that, and the function is just the identity function. The caplet on the other side is just paying Li with a different function, yeah, maximum of Li minus k and zero. And we choose the same natural numerator. The swaption. Okay, we had for the valuation of the swaption, we had to rewrite the swap as multiplying the swap rate with the swap annuity gives us the floating leg. And the fixed leg is a constant k multiplied with the swap annuity. So the swaption, also very nice example. The index is the swap rate. The swap rate is a martingale under my numerator choosing the swap annuity. So this here is the swap annuity. Okay, and the payment was then the call option on the swap rate. And you can also do the same for a cross currency option. So cross currency for an FX option. So I would like to have an option on receiving a unit of foreign currency for a predefined value. So that here is the predefined value of a domestic currency. So the ratio is then the foreign currency unit at the exercise date. So foreign currency zero Cooper bond divided by the domestic currency unit, domestic currency zero coupon bond. And you see, this is also a martingale if you choose here this guy as the numerator. So many things are of this form, yeah? So you have some index and you have some unit, and we have this nice relation that the index is a martingale under this measure corresponding to the numerator. So let's define this in the definition. We have the natural payoff unit. So we say that something is in its natural unit if I can write it as the index or a function of the index paid with some asset, yeah, where n can be chosen as a numerator, f is some deterministic function, and the index is then a martingale under Qn. So if f is linear, we call it a linear product. Otherwise, we call it a European option. Now, European because I just have a single time that fixes the index. Yeah? So later we could have options that observe the index at different times. So a small interpretation. So my index is always a unitless amount. Yeah. So if you go back to the table here, you see this is an asset divided by an asset. So it is one domestic currency divided by the domestic currency. It is a unitless amount. The same happens here. Yeah. It is a foreign currency multiplied with one domestic divided by one foreign. So it is a domestic currency unit divided by the domestic currency unit. It is a unitless amount. And the unit that is paid, so including the currency, is actually encoded in here this asset. So this asset also encodes the currency, and it also encodes the time. There's a small exception. So you see also here for the interest rate case, there is the exception. This guy here has unit one divided by time. And you see that the time fraction appears here. Well, from a mathematical point of view, it would be maybe nicer to move this time fraction here to the index. So the index is Li times the time period length. And then I have a unitless index, and here I have just the asset. But this then would make the notation a bit complicated. For example, for the swaption, the time length is here inside this swap annuity. Okay, so with the exception that actually this is a one divided by time in the interest rates, I have that the payoff unit contains the currency and also encodes the time, and the index is a unitless object. Okay, so we can now formulate this, yeah, in say some theorem. So if we are under this situation that a financial product pays a function of an index in the natural payoff unit, so in this numerator n, then I can choose this numerator, and then the whole valuation is given by taking the expectation of the function of this index. So if f is linear, we have a model independent value. If f is a piecewise linear function, then I need a model that gives me the distribution of x. If it is log normal, I get a Black-Scholes formula. If it is normal, I get a Bechelier formula. Well, we could derive now as an exercise, this is maybe nice, a generalized Black-Scholes formula. So a Black-Scholes formula, so our index follows the log normal process. So I know it is a martingale. So this here is under Qn. N is the corresponding numerator, the natural payoff unit here. So I have this log normal model. So the only parameter is the sigma x. And then I could consider a Black-Scholes-like formula for an arbitrary payoff that is just a piecewise linear function. Yeah. So we have intervals xi to xi plus one. So maybe here is my x1, x2, and so on. And then there's some xn minus one. Okay, and then you have a payoff function that is a piecewise linear function. Yeah, for example, you could have something like that. Then it goes like that. So you have a small digital option here. Yeah, and then it could go linear here, and yeah, maybe it drops to zero. Okay, so we have a piecewise linear function, and the task is to calculate the value. So what is the value in zero of this payoff? So I have to take my numerator and take the expectation qn of this thing here. Okay, divided by my numerator n of t f zero. So this thing is paid in units of n of t. So I have my numerator here below n of t and here above. Okay, so it cancels. So it's just the expectation of the function of this martingale. And yeah, this is the quantity which we have to calculate here. This, and since it is a piecewise linear function, I can decompose the expectation into just expectation of these linear parts over these intervals here. Okay, and you can calculate the value. Okay, so that's here maybe an exercise. Yeah, so you can derive now a formula. The formula will involve well, some terms, capital phi of something, yeah, where the points enter into the boundaries of the cumulative distribution function. So we will get some very general formula. Yeah? So you can value any piecewise linear payoff function under this Black-Scholes model, or the same for Bachelier. Okay, so, and now what happens if the financial product doesn't pay in this natural unit? So it pays in different unit as we had for the quanto caplet. So changing the unit from the natural one, say n, to some other unit, which I will now call m, yeah, this will of course change the value. And the change in value that is induced by this change is called the convexity adjustment. Well, the term convexity is maybe a bit strange, because if you think back to the quanto, it was a covariance term. So you see that for the quanto, it is the covariance between the index that we pay and the object that describes the change of measure. And we will have a similar result here. It will be, the adjustment will be related to the covariance of the index that we pay and the ratio of the numerator associated with the product and the natural numerator associated with the index. So it will be exactly like that. So maybe a much better name would be change of numerator covariance adjustment or whatever. But the term is called convexity adjustment. And a nice example that motivates this is here the so-called Leiber in arrears. So what's that? So it's a financial product that is like our floater. So the forward rate in arrears pays our forward rate, for the period from TI to TI plus one, fixed in TI. So if you have a timeline here, this here is the period TI to TI plus one, and it is paid in TI. So it is paid at the beginning of the period. Well, okay, so in arrears sounds strange. So actually, this means that the forward rate is paid in advance. Okay, so the forward rate is observed for this period here, and it is paid in advance. Well, maybe this is just an interpretation. You could also think of, and this is what is done in the financial product if it's traded, that you pay the interest rate for the past period. And if you pay it now for the future period or for the past period, this interpretation just depends on how you choose this scaling factor here. So this scaling factor is the past period. So I pay the forward rate for the period from TI to TI plus one. So assume this is always a 3 months period. I pay it at the end of the past period, which is the beginning of the period for which it is quoted. Okay, so I hope that this has not confused you. Yeah, I just want to mention that the word in arrears refers actually just to this interpretation that I view it as something for the past period. But of course, since I observe it in TI, so if I fix it in TI, it has to be the guy that is for the period from TI to TI plus one, and I pay it from a mathematical point of view. It's the forward rate for the period from TI to TI plus one paid at the beginning of the period. Okay, so to resolve a little bit the confusion, yeah, this guy here really doesn't matter. For us, it is just a constant. What really matters is the mismatch of the fixing and the payment. We fix at the beginning of the period and we pay also at the beginning of the period. So fixing and payment date coincide, and that's different from what we had before. Yeah? Before it was always fixing at the beginning, paying at the end. Forward rate paid in advance is maybe for us the better interpretation. The financial product is sometimes called forward rate in arrears. Okay, so how do you value this? So I write down the valuation in terms of the index, well, multiplied here with this period length, this is just a constant, multiplied with the numerator. So now the numerator is the bond that matures at the beginning of the period. So this here is now my payment time. So I write this again as index multiplied with pay of unit. Okay, so I pay that guy. Well, let's try to introduce the natural one. So if you would like to introduce the natural pay of unit, that is the bond that pays at the end of the period. So then here you have the ratio of the pay of unit of the financial product and the natural one. So here you have, like in our contour adjustment, the change of numerator. Okay, so but now observe that this is the bond at the beginning of the period divided by the bond at the end of the period. So for this guy here, I know that it is one plus the forward rate for this period, right? Both are fixed at the beginning of the period, so fixed in TI. Well, multiplied with the period length. So maybe let's move this guy a little bit. So the period length is now the natural one. Okay, so this guy, this change of numerator is just 1 plus the forward rate. So we have this here inside, okay? And the remainder is just the index that we pay. And now we pay that amount in the natural unit. Okay, so you see that there is an alternative interpretation. Instead of interpreting that I'm paying my index in a wrong unit, I can now interpret it as paying something in the right unit, but this something is now a nonlinear function. Yeah, this here is now paying a nonlinear function. So it is L ti minus ti minus 1 multiplied with 1 plus L. So you see there will be an L squared. So it is a nonlinear function here, multiplied with the natural unit. It's just a constant. So I have my natural unit here and there, a constant. And you see that everything would be nice if it would be just L times PTI plus 1. Yeah? So if we would just have here this part and that part, it would be nice, but now I have in addition a nonlinear part. Yeah, so nice. I could rewrite paying the linear function of the index in the wrong unit into paying a nonlinear function of the index in the right unit. So we have two different interpretations. So the first one is that we pay the index x of ti, but we pay it in the wrong unit, and x is not a martingale. Or we have the other interpretation that we pay a nonlinear function of this index. So x is now a martingale, which is nice, but the function is nonlinear. So since this is nice that it is a martingale, maybe let's give it a green color here. So the index is now a martingale. So we are now under the right measure, but I have a nonlinear function. So now take the expectation of this. Yeah, the expectation of this is the value. Expectation of this multiplied with the zero Cooper bond at evaluation time is the value. So now we value this. So if I now take the expectation, I have here my index in the right unit. I choose this natural unit as the numerator, but I have in addition this nonlinear part. Okay, I have a sum of something that is in natural unit and this nonlinear part. So there's something in the natural unit is here in front. I can value that. So expectation of L, L is a martingale. So this guy here cancels. Expectation of L is just L zero. So I can value that part, but I cannot take the expectation of the other part. Actually, I could if I had a model. Yeah. Why? Because you see there is the expectation of Li squared. Expectation of Li squared is something that depends on the variance. Yeah? It's the variance of Li squared that enters here. And so I need some stochastic properties. And you also see that the function that appears here is a convex function. Yeah, so we have a nonlinear function. So the additional term is the convexity adjustment. And you see that this is related because it is here a convex function. Yeah, so I have an x squared. So in general, the convexity adjustment is a covariance term. So in general, the convexity adjustment is a covariance term. Well, is this also a covariance term here? Well, the nice thing is, yes. Yeah. So remember, if we go back here to the Quanto caplet, you see that the covariance term that we experience there is the covariance between the index and the change of numerator. And here, our index is L, so I expect the covariance between the index L, sorry, no tilde, it is the domestic interest rate, L, and my change of numerator. Yeah, my change of numerator is M divided by N, where M is the bond at the beginning, and N is the bond at the end. Well, but M divided by N is, apart from the one plus, it is just L. Yeah. So you see that this is the covariance between L and L, which is the variance of L. So it's sigma L, and the rho, the correlation is 1. Yeah. So you see that actually the adjustment term here, which is the variance of L, is the variance of L because it is the covariance between the L and the change of numerator. Yeah, okay, appears to be a very general scheme behind this. Yeah. Let's try a more general formulation. Similar to what was on the previous slide, I now consider here the numerator n to be the natural one. So I assume that qn is the natural unit and x under qn allows for an analytic valuation formula. So I assume that I can calculate the value v when f of x is paid in units of n. Well, here I allow that it is paid at a later time, but actually you see on the next slide that this is not an issue, that we have a different time there. I just assume that I have this valuation formula. For example, we have the Black-Scholes-like formula for the caplet, because we pay in the natural unit. And then we move to the Quanto caplet, which has a different unit. So I assume now that we look at a different unit. So there is a traded asset M, and I consider paying the same function, but now I'm paying it in the different unit. So I pay f of x of t multiplied with the asset M observed in t star. So, and I do not know what is the value Vm. So what is the value Vm in zero? So that's the question now. Can I derive a connection between changing this unit and knowing the value under the natural unit? Well, if you think back of the derivation of the Quanto caplet, changing the numerator leads to a maybe complicated change of the drift of the index. So it leads to a change in the distribution of x of t. And here I have the x of t inside the function. So if you take this view, it appears to be very difficult to derive this because you do not know the function. Yeah, I just know the value here, but I do not know the function. But the thing is, if you take the change of numerator view, then the modification is just a multiplication on the outside. Okay, and then maybe we have more luck to derive this adjustment. Let's write down the value v of m. So we are looking for the value v subscript m. Yeah. So the value when we pay, to remind you, when we pay in units of m. So I pay f of x of t multiplied with m of t star. So the first thing you observe is, I assume that the t is below t star. You can just remove or replace the t star by the t. So why is that? So I consider valuation under the natural numerator. Okay, so the numerator appears here. Then I plug in the definition of my payoff function. So I pay f of x in units of m of t. And you see that this here is ft measurable. So the m of t star divided by the n of t star, this is a qn martingale. Yeah, because it is a traded asset, m, divided by my numerator. Yeah? So I can just apply again the moving the payment date technique and consider it as multiplying with m of t divided by n of t. Yeah? So it is like paying in t in the fixing time. Well, with this ratio, yeah, multiplying with m of t, n of t. Okay, so the t star is gone. So now I would like to express the value. So I'm looking here the v subscript m, so paying in units of m, in terms of my known formula vn. So I assume that vn of zero is known. So what I like to calculate is expectation of Vm divided by n under my natural numerator. Now let's rewrite here this guy. Okay, the Vm of t is f of x of t times in units of m. But then this is the same as saying, yeah, so now I do a little bit the same as for the motivation with the library in arrears. Assume I would pay in the natural unit. Okay. Then this is like paying in the natural unit and multiplying with m of t divided by n of t. So you see that this stuff is actually like paying the natural thing, which is here vn, and multiplying with the change of numerator, so which is here the m divided by n. Okay, and of course the numerator is still here. Okay, so I can rewrite the payoff. Yeah. So now all these guys are stochastic processes. So I can write the value of a stochastic process at a future time by saying it is the value of the stochastic process at initial time plus the integral over the change of the stochastic process. So I just use z of t is z of zero plus the integral from zero to t dz. Next step, plug this into our expectation. So all this here is now plugged into our expectation. So I have that Vm, so that was here on the left-hand side, is n0 multiplied with the expectation of this stuff. But expectation of this stuff here, yeah, it's just a constant, is just the stuff itself. So you see that the n0 cancels, and you have Vn of 0 multiplied with the change of numerator at evaluation time. So indeed, I can relate my Vm with the Vn using this little trick. Yeah, and you see, changing the payoff unit at payment time just introduce the same multiplicative change of the unit at evaluation time. Yeah? So this is natural because if you pay twice as much, I would expect that the value is twice as much. Plus an additional term, which comes from the expectation of the integral of the valuation process divided by the natural numerator and the change of numerator. Okay, so this guy here. Yeah, and this guy already looks a little bit like a covariance term. Yeah? So actually it is now the integrated instantaneous covariance of the natural numerator relative valuation and the change of numerator. So let's have a closer look at this expression. So the nice thing is that the two things, so let's mark it here, this one maybe with green, the value of my valuation formula under the natural payoff unit and the change of numerator. Well, both guys are martingales, yeah? So this is nice, okay? So this is nice because then if you use now here the product rule or say Itô's lemma or however you like to call it for this expression, yeah, d of x times y is y times dx plus x times dy plus dx dy. But the part where I just have one differential, for example, y times dx, well, it's a martingale. So the expectation of the integral from zero to t is just zero. Okay, so the only thing that is left is actually the cross term, the differential of vn divided by n and the differential of the change of numerator. And this is now my convexity adjustment. And if you have this formula, it's immediately clear that we can derive, for example, the adjustment for the Liber in arrears, yeah, or even for the quantor. Yeah, because for the Liber in arrears, the natural one is paying the Liber, yeah, the forward rate L at the end of the period. So divided by the numerator paying at the end of the period, this here is just the DL. So that would be just the DL. And again, this change of numerator here was 1 plus L times time period length. Okay, that was the change of numerator. But the differential of this is also just a DL, yeah, multiplied with a constant. So you see it is integrating the DL squared. So let's give this thing a name. So we are under the situation which we have just defined. So I assume that my x is a qn martingale, n is so the natural payoff unit. I consider paying in units of m. And then the difference of this payment in units of m and the payment in units of n and the natural one, well, multiplied with if the unit change also introduces a change in the amount, factor two or so, of course you have to adjust this, then this is just our convexity adjustment. So it's just the expectation of this integrated instantaneous covariance term. So this is called here our convexity adjustment. Okay, so the change of the payoff unit, of course, can be interpreted as a change of measure. Yeah, change of numerator is a change of measure. So what we have just written down is that we change from the measure Qn to the measure QM. And our measure change is exactly this ratio. Yeah? So the measure change is dQm by dQn. So the radonicotine derivative is exactly the n divided by m, well, multiplied with the m of t divided by n of t. So I already motivated and mentioned quite often that our convexity adjustment is a covariance term. And now we have maybe a more clearer picture. When we were discussing the quanto adjustment, actually at the end, we observed that instead of adjusting the value, we could just adjust the initial value of the index, which was very convenient because then in the Black-Scholes formula, we could just use the same formula and just modify the initial value of the index. So that was here on the slide. Yeah. So you see that we derived this drift and we could put this change, which is here this integrated covariance term, we could put this change here inside this logarithm such that it appears as if we change the initial value. That was a nice thing. Well, we can also do this here. So what we just did is we have, say, convexity adjusted value. If we have a linear payoff, say, for example, I just pay the index, like in the floater, multiplied with m. Okay, then this is making here this guy a bit easier, because then this is just the index. Then I can replace here, I have Vn. So actually I should add here that I also have Vn of zero is x of zero times n of zero. So like for the floater, forward rate in zero times the zero coefficient in zero. Then you see that you can just use here the x of zero. So you can divide by m of zero. So divide by the whole equation by m of zero. And you see that you can write the x zero that you should use in the valuation of Vm as an adjusted value. Okay. So I now introduce here an adjusted initial value of the index. And I ask myself, okay, what is the adjusted initial value of the index such that the valuation would look like the initial value of this adjusted index multiplied with the m of zero? Well, to do this, I have here now on the left-hand side my x tilde. So the x tilde is my adjusted value. So this x tilde should capture the whole adjustment. So and now I can solve that, divide everything by m zero. X tilde of zero is x of zero plus n of zero divided by m of zero multiplied with the expectation of this adjustment. Yeah. So I can introduce an adjusted initial value for the index. So actually this is what we had done for the quanto adjustment. So we can express the adjusted value with the unadjusted value plus and some covariance term. So it is that paying x of t in units of m of t is like paying x tilde divided by x zero times x of t in units of n of t.
Okay. So instead of saying I pay the right index in the wrong unit, I could say I pay a modified index in the right unit. And this is the reason why we could use then Black-Scholes formula. So now the modification moves inside of the F, yeah, and the unit is the right one, that we could use Black-Scholes formula for the Quanto caplet with just a modified initial value. Okay, that's a nice result. So in some cases, yeah, this is a remark, you can use this trick to obtain a convexity adjusted rate and use it inside the valuation formula. Yeah, so we get a convexity adjusted valuation formula. And this is often market practice. We have a nice example later where actually this is then needs some approximation to do it, but let's have a look later. Okay, so I have a few more examples for convexity adjustments. So that is now the general setup, yeah? And we cannot go any further unless we know now more about, say, the function f or the underlying model. Yeah? So if the underlying model is a log normal process, I can maybe derive a little bit more if I know that my function is just a European option on the index, a maximum function. Maybe I can also derive a little bit more. But apart from that, we now have just derived the general scheme. Okay, so let's stop here. Yeah, so that was a bigger session here on convexity adjustment. And maybe you can go back and review some of the examples now in view of these formulas. So we can do this in the next session. Thanks.